Hey, welcome home. We're so glad you're here. Where are my always 10-minute late people? Where are you at? Yeah, get it up there proud. Most of y'all relate to this service. Put your hand up. That's fine. Where is the 20 minutes early people? Yes, I was always raised, if you're on time, you're what? You're late. See, those of you who are 20 minutes early, you can't be on time. If you're on time, you're late. So glad you're here. I don't always say, hey, make sure you're here at a particular event. But tonight, at our team huddle, I'm going to say to you, make sure you're there. This is going to be laughter, vision, fun, celebration. Do not miss this. If you are a leader, if you serve, if you're on our team in any capacity, be here. If you're newer to the church and you're just checking it out and you're wondering, what does it look like to be on that team, to serve there, to be a leader there? What does it look like? What's really happening? Come and just check out what the Lord is doing here. One of the things that we're going to talk about tonight is what we believe God is up to and where we're headed over the next 24 to 30 months as a church. And we're going to lay the vision out and say, this is where we're going. This is what God has called us to. And I believe we're going to look back in 24 to 30 months and we're going to go, God did exceedingly abundantly more than we could ask, think, or imagine. And some of you are going to be like, I was there, that team huddle, when they first started talking about where we're headed and what it's going to take to get there. So be here tonight, 5 o'clock. So we're going to have some fun. If you're new to the church, like, we take Jesus really, really seriously, but not ourselves. And so if you've ever watched an episode of The Office and you've seen the Dundies, we have our own version. We're going to have the Nolies tonight. And so it's going to be a lot of fun. So tonight, Team Huddle, be there. We're starting a new series today in the book of Ruth. So grab a copy of the scriptures, open to Ruth. I'll pray. We'll jump in. Jesus, thank you for today, that you are with us, that you're moving. Even when we don't see it, you're working. And I pray that we would be a group of people that, regardless of what life appears to be like, we could say, it's well with my soul because you are good and we know the God that controls all things. In Jesus' name. And everybody said? All right. Let me begin by asking you a question. And the question is, does order ever come from disorder? On its own, does the laundry at your house just wash itself? Does your kid's room naturally put itself back together on its own? Does the kitchen just clean itself up? Does things in your home go from disorder to order on its own? Does a tornado go through a scrapyard and then just form a Boeing 747 jet? Yes or no? No, order doesn't naturally come from disorder. There's nothing in the natural world that would say order comes from disorder. I'm just grateful that we don't serve a natural God, that we serve a supernatural God who takes disorder and takes chaos and makes order and beauty. And one of the reasons why I love the book of Ruth is because it's a little distinct from other books and the way we read and see how God works. Because throughout much of the Bible, you read and God is intervening directly and supernaturally. And so you see the parting of the Red Seas. You see him sending plagues. You see him raising the dead. And you're like, man, that's God right there. That was a miracle. I saw it. A burning bush speaks. A prophet says, thus says the Lord. God's intervention, God's protection, God's provision, it's obvious and it's clear. You can't miss it. But in the book of Ruth, it's so relatable to our lives. God doesn't speak through any dreams. In 4 chapters, there's not one recorded miracle, no visible supernatural occurrences. But instead, in Ruth, what we see is we see this unseen, sovereign hand of God always working in the lives of his people behind the scenes, completely in control, but often unnoticed. And man, I love the big splashes of supernatural events, but I also love that even when I can't see it, man, God is at work. And if we're not careful, then we can casually go through our lives
and just miss the whispers of God. We can miss the beauty in the chaos. We can miss the peace and the pain. And over the next 4 weeks, we're going to walk through the book of Ruth, one chapter a week. Now, that doesn't mean my sermons are going to be really long. Take a deep breath. That's not what it means. But we're going to take one chapter a week because there's this progression of story that's marvelous, spectacular, and it's going to build your faith. So Jesus, today, as we jump into your word, would you be strong where we are weak? And would you remind us that even when we don't see it, you're working for our good and your glory, in Jesus' name. And everybody said? So we're going to begin chapter 1, verse 1, the book of Ruth. I invite you, man, have a copy of the scriptures out, have it dialed up on your phone. But let's look at what God's word says. So, verse 1, during the time of the what? The judges. Hey, this is the group participation start of the part of the sermon. So if I ask, you got to respond or we'll just keep doing this. You'll be here all day, okay? So during the time of the judges, good. Now that's the setting for the book of Ruth, the time of the judges. Now, this was before Israel had any kings, and it was actually a really dark time in Israel. Judges 21:25 says that in those days, the times of the judges, that everyone did what was right in his own eyes. So it was a time of lawlessness and chaos, sin abounded. That's what's happening during the time of the book of Ruth. So during the time of the judges, there was also a what? Famine. Now, this is a judgment from God against his people in order to bring them back to himself. He withholds the rains in order to get them to respond back to him. So there's a famine in the land, and a man left Bethlehem in Judah with his wife and his two sons to stay in the territory of Moab for a while. And Bethlehem actually means house of bread and praise. But there's a famine in the land, and the house of bread and praise is completely out of bread. And the man, whom we'll meet in just a second, says, hey, I don't like what's happening here. Things are getting hard. I don't like what God is choosing. I'm going to leave here and go try to find some other food. So we'll meet our characters. And the man's name was Elimelech. Some people say Elimelech. I prefer Elimelech. And the man's name was Elimelech, and his wife's name was Naomi. Now, Elimelech means my God is king, and Naomi means pleasant. And the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. And some of you are expecting, or maybe you're planning to have sons one day, and you're like, man, those are decent names. I could choose. Maybe you're a Star Wars fan or a Star Trek. Don't do that. This means unhealthy and puny. Don't name your boys that. And they were Epaphrodites from Bethlehem and Judah, and they entered the fields of Moab, and they settled there. So do you understand what's happening? There's a famine in the land, no food. Elimelech takes his wife and his two sons, and he decides to leave and go to Moab. And you may be thinking, well, that's not that big a deal. He wanted security. He wanted to find food. He just needs to feed his family. He just wants some provision for his people. It's a really big problem, and it was a really bad decision on behalf of Elimelech, because this is how God describes Moab. God says in Psalm, Moab is my washpot. And that doesn't mean a place where you go to get clean. This is describing like the leftover dirty water in a basin after people have had a bath. He's saying that's what Moab is like. And Moab was actually named after a person, Moab, check this, whose birth was the result of an incestuous relationship that Lot had. So Moab was not a great place. It was Sin City. It was a dark place. It had a lot of temples, but all of their temples were to false gods and were full of prostitutes. And God's people were told, don't ever go to Moab. Don't go to Moab. Where does Elimelech take his people? Moab. He's leaving the promised land. He's saying, God, I don't like what you're doing. I don't agree with your choices. Life is hard. I'm going to make it on my own. I feel a little abandoned by you in this moment, and so I'm going to turn from what God has provided when times are hard, and I'm going to go to Moab. That's what he's doing. Elimelech is taking his family, leading them away from God to a foreign place. Now check this, presumably for a very temporary stay. I doubt Elimelech said, hey, you know, hitch up the U-Haul. This is a permanent move to Moab. We are relocating. Better schools, better tax structure, better jobs. We're going to head to Moab and make a new living. No, this was presumably a temporary stay. No food, famine, judgment. They have food. Let's go there. I know, God, you don't want me to go there, but it's really a temporary fix. I know it's not your best, but I'm going to go there temporarily. I need to do this now to provide my own way because you're not taking good care of me. I bet it was a temporary move. Now, there's an old saying that bears repeating, and old sayings bear repeating because they're old sayings and they're weighty. And the old saying is this: sin will always take you farther than you want to go and keep you there longer than you want to stay. Elimelech said, okay, it's not God's best, but it's just a temporary stop. We'll be back before he knows it. And look what happens at the next verse. Well, Naomi's husband, Elimelech, what? Mr. My God is King, didn't act like his God was king, because when times got tough, he ran and he ended up dying, and she was left with her two sons. So now he's left his wife and his two sons in a foreign place. And we don't know how he died or why he died. It could have been old age. It could have been a heart attack. He could have been hit by a camel. We don't know. What we do know is that he left Bethlehem to escape death, but he ran away from God's best, took his family into sin, and death still found him. Now look at what happens in verse 3. Well, her sons, and they follow in dad's footsteps, they took Moabite women as their wives. One was named Orpah, not Oprah, but Orpah, and the second was named Ruth, and they lived in Moab about 10 years. So they didn't make this a temporary stop. They dug in some roots, but both Mahlon and Chilion also died, and the woman was left without her two children and without her husband. Elimelech's decisions and his sin is actually being multiplied. So the boys, Mahlon and Chilion, see dad's pattern of disobeying God, and they decide not only to stay in Moab, but let's go ahead and marry some Moabite women. And so parents, let me just put a pin in the sermon for just a moment and help you realize what a powerful impact you have on your children with the pattern of your decision making. You're going to leave a legacy in the lives of those you lead. And your decisions, they matter far more than you can imagine. Elimelech says, it's okay if we temporarily disobey God. And his pattern of decision making has ripple effects on his families for multiple generations. And Mahlon and Chilion, man, they marry Orpah and Ruth, and they live there for 10 years. They don't conceive any children, and then they both pass away. Naomi's family is literally teetering on extinction at the worst possible time in history. Not only is she experiencing the tragic death of her husband and her sons, but she doesn't have any grandchildren. She's in Moab with no church and no biblical community. This is desperation. And what I love about the scriptures is that the scriptures really give you an unvarnished look at life. Not everything is always a bed of roses. Birds don't always wake us up and sing all the good long. Sometimes it's just hard. And sometimes the longer you walk with Jesus, the harder it gets. And we don't follow Jesus because he makes this life better. We follow Jesus because he's our king and this world's not our home. And so Naomi, man, she's in a dark spot. It's tough. So let's see what happens, verse 6. So she, that's Naomi,
and her daughters-in-law set out to return from the territory of Moab because, check this, she had heard in Moab that the Lord had paid attention to his people's need by providing them food. So she left the place where she had been living. She's like, let's head back, accompanied by her two daughter-in-laws there in tow, and they traveled along the road leading back to the land of Judah. She decides, let's go back. God has revisited the land of Judah. There's going to be food. Let's go home. And Orpah and Ruth decide to go with her, and look what happens in verse 8. Well, Naomi said to them, hey, I don't know why you're following me, but each of you should go back to your mother's home. May the Lord show kindness to you as you have shown to the dead and to me. May the Lord grant each of you rest in the house of a new husband. And she kissed them and they wept loudly. She said, you need to return. Don't come with me. My life is filled with nothing but pain. Stop and go back. Look at verse 11. But Naomi replied, return home, my daughters. Why do you want to go with me? Am I able to have any more sons who could become your husbands? She's like, that's not going to happen. Return home, my daughters. Go on, for I am too old to have another husband. Even if I thought there was still hope for me to have a husband tonight and to bear sons, check this out, would you be willing to wait for them to grow up? Would you restrain yourselves from remarrying? No. No, my daughters, my life is much too bitter for you to share because the Lord's hand has turned against me. You need to go back. The Lord has abandoned me. Like, I'm going back to my ancestors' land. I'm going back where I hear God is. I'm going back. But if you go with me, you're going to find nothing but pain. So go back to your family. I got nothing to offer. There's this custom in Israel that when an Israelite widow dies, one of his brothers was supposed to marry the widow to provide for her and to continue the name. And that's what she's referring to. But as she says, hey, there's not even anyone for me to marry, and there's no sons for you to marry. And even if I did marry, I'm too old and too barren to even have a son. And even if I did get married, and even if I did have a son, are you going to hang out 20 years and then marry the one whose diapers you used to change? Not going to happen. Hopeless, go home. Ruth, look, even if we started a dating profile, what's the line? Bitter old woman and foreign daughter. Like, that's not the top of the list of a bunch of single guys. They're just going to keep swiping. That's not going to happen. So Naomi has gotten to the point in her life where she believes she has nothing to offer, and her outlook is so bleak that people shouldn't even be around her. Game over. She's not the only person in history to get to that point in their life. And there's a lesson in that, and it's this. We choose hopelessness. We choose hopelessness when we decide that God's against us. When we make it up in our minds, game over, God's against me, God's abandoned me, no hope, avoid me. In that moment, we choose hopelessness. And Naomi has become bitter. And I'm not judging her bitterness on her circumstances. That's more than any one person should endure. But at this point, Naomi can't see the rays of light kind of peeping around the clouds. And the reality is, many people say, man, the size of my problems and the amount of my pain, that determines God's power. But that's not true. The size of your problems and your pain don't have anything to do with the amount and size of God's power. So even though her problems are huge, God's power is limitless. And God is about to begin right before our eyes restoring Naomi. Because there's another principle that you need to always remember, and it's this, is that there is hope. There is hope because our God never leaves us. That's his character. That's his nature. And Naomi, at this point, She's not seeing it. She's not feeling it. And she's getting ready to head home. And I love this interaction between her and Ruth. It's beautiful. Check it out. And again, they wept loudly. Lots of crying. And Orpah kissed her mother-in-law. So Orpah takes off. She's not staying. But Ruth clung to her. And Naomi said, look, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. Follow your sister-in-law. One more time. You need to leave. But Ruth replied, don't plead with me to abandon you or to return and not follow you. And then if you're not familiar with the book of Ruth, you're probably very familiar with what she says next. She says this, for wherever you go, I will go. And wherever you live, I will live. And your people will be my people. And your God will be what? My God. Ruth going with Naomi is crazy at this point. Naomi has already said, if you follow me, you're entering into a life of pain. Ruth, you have to leave your family. You have to leave all of your comforts and your security. And as far as you know, you're entering into a life of widowhood and childlessness. I don't have a man to give. There's no inheritance. There's no money. There's no food. You're going to go to an unknown land with new people and new languages and new culture. There's no security. There's no social systems in that day. There's nothing to provide for these women. But Ruth makes this radical commitment, a commitment really more radical than marriage when she said this. She said, yeah, but where you die, I will die. And there I will be married. Naomi, wherever you go, I'm with you till the end, and I'm not leaving. In other words, I'm not returning to Moab. Not even, Naomi, if you die. I'm with you. And she's with her because of what she said back in 16, which was remarkable. She said this, your God will be my God. This may be lost on us a little bit because we're several thousand years removed, but Ruth's a Moabite from the washpot, unclean, unworthy, dirty, despised. God's people were told to avoid them. Don't even go near them. But God is showing you a picture of his heart because God is drawing Ruth to himself. God is showing the world that there's no one outside his love. I doubt that Naomi had painted such a glorious picture of her God that Ruth just wanted in. That bitter old woman said, run, not come. But God was providing this irresistible draw on Ruth's heart. That God's call on Ruth was so spectacular. And here's why. Because when God calls someone, he calls them out of and beyond their circumstances. He calls them beyond and out of their past and into his plans and into his future. And maybe you know how this book ends. But spoiler alert, check this. Ruth is going to go back with Naomi to Bethlehem. And Naomi doesn't have another son, but a son one day is going to be born in Bethlehem. There's going to be a son one day born in Bethlehem that actually left heaven and came to earth, was crucified and buried again. That son's name was Jesus. And do you know who that son is related to? Ruth, the Moabite. That God is actually going to weave this Moabite woman from the washpot into his son's lineage. And so I don't know where you feel like God has abandoned you. Nor do I know where you feel like you've gone too far. But God is demonstrating to you that there's no one and no sin beyond his reach. Him taking Ruth and putting him in the lineage of Christ is a testimony to you that you are loved and accepted by the Father. Now, you still need to come back the next 3 weeks because we got to unpack all that. But at this point, Naomi doesn't see any of that.
We don't understand that at all. It's God's providence behind the scenes. And then what I want you to see next is the encounter that happens when Naomi shows back up in Bethlehem. She's been gone 10 years in Moab. She shows back up, and look at the response of the crowds. Now, I can imagine, if you could imagine what a bunch of church folk, Baptist-y people might say after being gone 10 years, right? Well, I want you to watch what happens. When Naomi saw, this is maybe my funniest verse. When Naomi saw that Ruth was determined to go with her, she what? She's talking, I just think that's hilarious. You don't have to. You could be wrong. I think it's hilarious. Naomi's like, go back, run away. She's like, I'm going with you. Like, okay, fine. And the two of them traveled until they came to Bethlehem. And when they entered Bethlehem, the whole town was what? Bitter, frustrated, judgmental, condoning, excited about their arrival. And the local women exclaimed, can this be Naomi? She shows back up to the people of God after being gone 10 years. And their response wasn't judgment, it was welcome home. This is an incredible picture of what the community of faith should be like, that God always welcomes the wayward, and so should we, that God embraces the outsider, and so should we. So the reason why we say welcome home here all the time isn't absolutely just for no reason. It's because no matter where you've been or what you've done or where you've gone, when you walk into the people of God, we want to say, hey, man, welcome home. They were excited to see her. Ruth, Naomi, where you been? Who's the Moabite? Tell us the story. They're just glad she's there. And then watch Naomi's response in verse 20. Don't call me Naomi, remember, which means pleasant. Call me Mara, she answered, for the Almighty has made me very bitter. You're about to see sort of the snot bubble, ugly cry moment for Naomi right here. I went away full, but the Lord has brought me back empty. And why do you call me Naomi, since the Lord has opposed me and the Almighty has afflicted me? Don't call me pleasant anymore, call me bitter. The Lord has afflicted me. And you know, if we're honest, there are more than one instance in our lives where we don't like, we disagree with, or we're hurt by what would seem God's choices are. Why would he allow that? Why would he choose that? Why did that happen? It's never, ever, ever what I would have chosen, but why is that what God allowed? And what I love about Naomi is she doesn't bury her frustration. She puts them out there. She puts them out there. You know what we do? We lie. Because sometimes people come up and they're like, hey, how you doing? And what's your response? Oh, you know, yeah. How you doing? Fine. Great. Blessings. Peace to you, brother. Whatever. Not Naomi. Naomi, how's it going? It's horrible, and it stinks, and I'm on a sinking ship. Oh, well, let's talk about that. She's honest. Some people say, well, she has a lack of faith. I don't think so. Naomi doesn't do this in private. She goes back to her hometown, back to where God's presence is, back to God's people. She doesn't rail against God in private. She actually airs her frustrations with the people of God. She airs her frustrations with her sisters in the faith that can call her up. They can speak life into her. It's one of the reasons why we tell you all the time, you need to be in a group here. You need to be around other people that can speak life into you and encourage you and call you up. And you may not feel comfortable having the snot bubble ugly cry in this room. I get that. But you need to have a place, have a group of people where you can say, this is what's going on in my life. And not be worried about judgment, but be called into something greater. And that's what Naomi is doing here. And as a matter of fact, I love in those verses Naomi's theology. We'll look at it, but I think her theology in those verses is pretty spectacular. And I'll take her theology over some of the sentimental views of God that dominate our world and dominate our churches. Because even though she feels bitter and frustrated and heartbroken, she's convinced of three things, and here they are. She's convinced God exists. This isn't by accident. There is a creator. There is a God. He's sovereign, meaning he's in complete control. I don't have to like it. It's not what I would choose, but he's in control. And he's allowed difficulty to come into my life. That's pretty good theology. There is a creator. And he's in complete control. And even though I wouldn't choose it, he has allowed difficulty to come into our lives. We can learn a few things from Naomi. Because the reality is there is a God who exists and he is sovereign. And he reigns in every square inch of your life. He rules the nations, Daniel 2:12. And he rules our families. And his providence, his control, his influence extends from the U.S. Congress to your kitchen. John Piper says that nothing from a toothpick to the Taj Mahal is rightly understood apart from its relationship to God. And whatever Naomi doubted, she didn't doubt that God was the one in complete control. He gives rain and he takes it. He sends famines and he takes them back. Gives life and he takes it. In him we breathe and move. Naomi hadn't given up on God. She knew he was in total control. She didn't see the ray of hope, but she hadn't given up. And the ray of hope is coming. Look at verse 22. So Naomi came back from the territory of Moab with her daughter-in-law, Ruth, the Moabitess, and they arrived in Bethlehem at the beginning of the barley harvest. Now, I know it all makes sense. The Bible's just clear now, right? But the barley harvest was right at the beginning of spring. And the barley harvest began immediately after the Passover. So this was, for the people of God, a time of celebration. It was a time of plenty, a time of food, a time of abundance. And God is restoring Naomi right before our eyes. And it's because of the barley harvest that Ruth is going to meet this incredible character. And there's going to be this transition and there's going to be this relationship. And I don't want to give it all away, but there's hope percolating out of the end of chapter 1. She just doesn't see it. And there have been so many times in my life where I have wept. And I felt broken, and hope was bursting forth, but I wasn't ready to see it yet. And you look back on this chapter, and it might be easy to think, man, God really has dealt harshly with Elimelech and his family. Like, there's a lot of unfortunate events happening right there. Well, yeah. Did you know that the Bible never promises that believers escape a mess? Did you know that? Even if Naomi was the one who didn't want to go, and she was praying against going, and she was always wanting to go back, and couldn't believe Elimelech took her there, that she had no responsibility in the issue, God never promises that believers escape a mess. We have to stop believing that. But what if... what if, and we don't know, but what if Naomi was complicit? What if she had been dropping those seeds in Elimelech's ear for a while? You know, I heard Moab's got a nice brisket. Hey, what if we go to Moab? Hey, they got food. Hey, let's go. We're not going to sell the house. We'll rent it out. We'll just go for a temporary stay. We'll come back. Better taxes, good schools. What if we just leave for a little bit? What if she was completely complicit in their going? And part of the hardship that she's experiencing is a result of her own sinful decisions. What if that were true? See, if that were true, then in my estimation, the way this story ends up is even more encouraging. Because she walked out on God, but God didn't walk out on her. And God is restoring her and bringing her back. And not only her, but Ruth. And she's bringing her back into this family. And there's this restoration of a woman that's absolutely miraculous if you'll see this book through with us. And one of the things I want all of us to walk away with today is an understanding that there are times in our life when we can see the hand of God move and it's crystal clear and obvious, and those are anchors in our life that build our faith. I love that we have those. But there are other instances in our life that feel chaotic and painful, and we don't always know where God is, and we wonder if he has forgotten us. And what Ruth is going to teach us is God is always present, always working, even when we don't see him. And so, Jesus, thank you for your faithfulness, for your presence, for your provision. Remind us today, God, of the times and places where you've just intervened so tangibly. But also remind us, God, that even when we don't see you, you're working. In Jesus' name, amen.